put your name on it. Just put your name on it. That's all I say. Be a man or a woman. Put your name on it.
Well, I'd like to hear about it, potheads.
How the fuck you gonna know how to be great if you don't study greatness? Look at the game tape.
Donuts.
If you wanna battle, it's either that you will or you won't.
You know, you're not a bad looking man, Mr. Gals.
But you are, Blanche. You are in that chair.
There's something wrong with us. Something very, very wrong with us.
Hey everybody, check this out. If you want to get something from Amazon, go to jmoore.com and we get a kickback on the show. That's how we pay for Angie's t-shirt habit. This is from James Francia. I hope I'm pronouncing that right, James. JJ, just hit up the Amazon link on your website to buy my smoking hot biologist nerd wife a book called The National Audubon Society Field Guide to the Southwestern States, Arizona, New Mexico, Nevada, Utah, parentheses, Audubon Field Guide. Nerds! And a new iPad case from my sister, whose three-year-old busted their last iPad. Love to see you next time you're up in the Bay Area. Sometime, since it's only a few minutes away from my house, keep up the great work and screw anyone who complains about you only having six impressions. They are comedy gold. That's from James Francia. Let me tell you something, friends. I don't have only six impressions. I have like 7.5. So you could take that right under the arches, people. Go to jmoore.com, click the Amazon link, do some shopping. If you're going to Amazon anyway, go to jmoore.com, and then we can pay for I got nothing. Just do it. It'll be good. Clear the cookies. And mostly, just enjoy the podcast. And I really enjoy your guys' feedback on Twitter and on iTunes. It means the world to me. I love you, and listen up. This will be good. I promise.
As I'm reading that, Otto, all I can imagine is George telling me to blow everybody in the building because it would take less time.
Well, it's a commercial read. It was good.
You're Otto of Otto and George fame. Maybe George will show up later, but there's more. Like, you're more fascinating than like an inanimate object. That's got to be hard to be. I guess puppet act is a layman's term.
Well, yeah, a boat act. That's what comedians called me when I started. Prop act. You know, they put me down.
But now you've become. You've ascended into like this legendary status. You're like Sasquatch. Like your name comes up. Everyone has an Otto story.
There's more sightings of me. Yeah, I guess so. Because, you know, if you're around long enough, they call you a legend, I guess.
No, that's not. No, I think, you know, I don't think it's because you're around a long time. I just think it's what you do is so upper 1% of. First of all, for people listening, at Otto and George, AOTTO. GEORGE at Otto and George and OttoandGeorge.com. I think what makes you, this will be like the actor studio of Otto Petersen. I think what makes you so separate from the rest of us and the reason just regular guys.
Poverty.
Yeah. Gary Goldman was here a while ago and he had a lot of poverty stories.
Does he?
Yeah.
Okay.
Like, do I want avocado? Well, you think I got that kind of money?
Really?
But what separates
with no money? Weird.
Yeah.
How'd that work out?
What separates you from the rest of us is you never wavered. You started like you're the dirtiest guy that probably any of us know. Would you agree? Do you know anyone dirtier than you?
I say fuck. Who doesn't? I mean, the MC says cunt in the first 3 seconds of his show now. So, you know. It's good, you know, the shock thing to, you know, audiences want that. The question was what?
The question is, do you know of other comics that are dirtier than you?
Yeah, definitely. Bob Levy's way filthier than me. I can't follow him. He's disgusting. Yeah.
Joe DeRosa is joining us, too. I almost missed out on you, Buttercup.
I know.
Hi, Joe.
How are you, sweetheart?
You look good, Warden from Midnight Express.
You look good, too. I got to say, every time I see you, it puts a smile on my face.
Aww.
Your lovely wife's here. The guys are here. Otto. I love seeing you too, man.
I haven't seen you since Montreal. We were up there with Patrice that a few years ago.
Yeah, how great was that?
It was awesome.
The only time I ever did shows with Otto, it was the last show in Montreal. It was Patrice, Otto, and George, me, and
Nick DiPaolo. Jerk off Canadian guy that sucked. Yeah. Remember that fucking hick? Yeah, he was horrible.
Yeah, the kid with all the shit in his face.
Yeah, usually Canadian comics are okay. Yeah,
a lot of piercings and things.
Yeah,
what a jerk. Let me sit closer.
All right.
To me, you know what I mean?
Okay. It was fun watching Patrice eat that Subway sandwich every day in the dressing room. It was like a magic trick. It was there and it was gone. It was just boom.
Like a slide whistle into his mouth.
Yeah, exactly.
Next to me.
Yeah.
You were doing that bit up there where it was every night in the middle of Otto's set. You know, because we were all downstairs in the screen room, so you'd go back and forth up and down all night, and you'd only catch pieces of everybody's set every night. And a couple times I came up, and I caught you as you were reenacting the Kennedy situation, this shooting with the dummy. Yeah.
That's what his mom calls it. Remember that situation with my son Jack?
Situation.
That's what Sam Giancana calls it.
The Kennedy situation.
Yeah.
So he would be reenacting it, and he would do the shots, and he'd flip the dummy forward, and the hair would flip up, and the brains would come out of the dummy.
Yeah.
And then the dummy would always go, "They're shooting, Norton. They're shooting."
Yeah, I turned into a honeymooner's bit. Yeah.
Put the top on, Norton. They're shooting us.
Yeah.
I saw you do that at Rascals.
Yeah.
That's one of the greatest bits
I've
ever seen, because what's weird about any guy with a figure – dummy, we would call
figure's
it.
Figure's good.
Okay, any guy with a figure.
That was respectful.
See that? My wife taught me that.
Yeah,
any guy with a figure, what becomes weird with the act is the audience. And I guess that's if you're good, that's part and parcel for the show, is if you're really good at it, the audience is just staring at your figure.
That's the
object. For the layman, the puppet.
Yeah.
So George, and for the listeners, figure means puppet. So I'm going to go back and forth until you get used to it, and I'll just switch over to figure. Explain the whole. All right. Yeah. So people are just staring at the puppet the whole show, and then people get irate at what George is saying. And it's the strangest thing in the world that people – I've seen it with my own eyes. I've seen it at Caroline's. I've seen it at the Boston Comedy Club, where audience members get so irate, they begin finger-pointing and screaming at the puppet, like calling him a son of a bitch, like, "I dare you to come off that stage and say that shit to my face." Like that must fascinate – I guess that's like what you want to have happen, because it means you're that effective of a ventriloquist.
Well, yeah. I mean, walking a few people is important to me, because you're getting rid of the dipshits in the audience that can't take it anyway, you know, don't get it, you know. Comedians just get judged too harshly, you know. They think you mean everything you say, which is completely false. Like, I mean, Jack Nicholson doesn't chase people with an axe in real life because, you know, he's in The Shining. But, you know, they think if I say something, I mean it, you know.
Right.
But I don't think they think that you even
say
it. I don't even think they think you say it. I think they really believe – like when I watch you, I've seen you probably 40 times. I'm staring at George. And I watch George – and Colin and I have sat here and had this conversation. Joe and I have had this conversation. There's like – I guess what I'm trying to say is you're a bigger deal than you think. Like, you're the guy comics marvel at when you're not – in a good way. Like, when you're not around, we sit around going, how does he do it? Specifically, I'll watch – if you see Otto and George, which you should, but if you're an R-rated – if you tap out at R, don't – you're going to be one of the people he walks and you're going to be like, I don't get it at all. But if you're the nitty-gritty Opie and Anthony, Ron and Fez crew – get after it and make sure you go see Otto and George. But you – like the dummy will look at somebody in the audience and say like, are you Chinese, miss? And then what Colin and I were like fascinated about was you – this like no one thinks about the math and the work that you have to do, Otto. Like
yeah,
no one realizes –
standing the audience
you have to see the person. And then Colin and I got fascinated with how much time goes by before – you know, Otto sees the Chinese lady in the third row, and then that time where the dummy just slowly turns his head over and acts like he recognizes her.
Yeah.
Is it different every night?
Yeah, it's different every night. There's not always a Chinaman available, you know. You have to go to the Puerto Rican or whatever. Yeah, it's different, sure.
But is it right away? I mean, if there is someone in the front row, right when you see them, do you just have the figure look over?
And start talking to them? Second. Or do you know, like, you know, I'm going to save that for later because I'm kind of cooking with
crowd work is weird because it's hard to go back into your act after you get a big laugh from working the crowd. It's almost like you can't follow that, your own act, you know, and then you have to just stick with crowd work. So I don't try – I try not to do – but as far as being dirty, I did that just so the comics would put me on early in the showcase clubs in the beginning. You know, I didn't want to wait around till 2 in the morning and go on after Andy Kaufman at the Improv. So if I was dirty and the comics would like me, they'd put me on early. That was the main objective for working dirty.
Did they put you on early because they wanted to watch you?
Yeah. They wanted to see me go kill with a, you know, packed room. Because I was a street performer and, you know, it just sucked waiting 3 hours to do a set when I can go out on the corner and do 10 shows in an hour, you know.
Your photos on Twitter that you just put up like a month ago were incredible because it's like the 70s.
Yeah.
And you look like freaking Sal from Dog Day Afternoon. You got like a weird hat. You got the long hair and like the hangdog look. And it's funny, like even then, you should check out at Otto and George on Twitter because the photos that Otto shares with you guys, like how often do you see like a photo of someone doing a show from like 75. I mean, it's so incredible. To see New York.
New York was cool then. Times Square was great. 42nd Street was awesome.
Yeah.
Double features. You know, going to the movies, 9 a.m. in the morning, playing hooky. It was great.
When did you start doing ventriloquism? Were you a kid?
Yeah, I'm about 7.
And what was it like, Edgar Bergen? Like what?
Paul Winchell. You ever heard of him?
No.
Jerry Mahoney and Knucklehead. He had a TV show. He was great. He did the voice of Scrubbing Bubbles, that TV commercial.
Yeah.
Paul Winchell. What else did he do? The voice of one of the Winnie the Pooh guys. He was great.
Was he Tigger?
He might have been Tigger the Tiger, yeah.
Yeah, because that guy was –
Yeah, that's
read.
The bubble guy.
Yeah, right?
At Joe DeRosa Comedy.
Yes.
Is that your Twitter address?
Yeah, that is my Twitter.
How come everybody has to put comedy – in your case, they should put comedy in quotes.
Oh, come on.
I just had to do something.
I know. Some people – they've gotten that one a few times.
Jay Larson Comedy, Joe DeRosa Comedy.
Well, because Joe DeRosa was taken.
Well, go tell the guy to get lost.
There's another Joe DeRosa in comedy or in
– No, in just in life.
Oh.
There are many.
Yeah.
There are many, so I had to put – but that was also the name of my website, so I just kept it. Because JoeDeRosa.com was taken for a wedding.
Oh, that's
some wedding cocksucker.
Really?
So yeah.
What did you use instead?
A Joe DeRosa Comedy.
Oh, okay.
So then I made it my Twitter handle, so you make it all – it's my email. You make it all universal.
It's like an iCloud for Joe DeRosa.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly.
It's kind of like – that's the default website. Like if jmore.com was taken when it was, it's jmorelive.com. Mm-hmm. Like Bobby Kelly still. It's Bobby Kelly Live. Bobby Kelly Live. Bobby Kelly Comedy. Jay Larson Comedy.
Yeah, what else do you do?
You get Matt Frost to call some, you know, guy in Chicago sitting in your domain name to knock him loose.
That's right.
You got to get somebody in there to crack heads.
Today. I want to call back to something you were talking about with Otto earlier when Jay was talking about the dummy.
It's a figure, Joe. That's like the N-word.
I'm sorry.
To them.
The figure having the mind of its own.
Yeah.
Two things about this.
One thing. He doesn't. It's a figure.
So. Yeah. But the appearance that it does, the funniest thing I've ever seen you do, for me personally, I mean, that's made me laugh the hardest, and I've told this story a million fucking times, was you were Caroline's, and there's this like 300-pound Italian guy in a sport coat sitting stage right, and you're looking straight ahead talking to the people, and all of a sudden George turns his head and looks down at the Italian guy, and he goes, "Holy shit. What the fuck is the size of that jacket, you fucking zilch?" It was like knives, dude. I was laughing so hard. And I can't even remember if the guy thought it was funny or not.
Yeah.
I just remember laughing
take your
and
life
thinking
in your hands with Italians.
Yeah, I mean it was so funny. And then the thing I want to add to this is you make that thing seem so real. And you really think it's another person up there. When we were at the Nasty Show in Montreal, I took pictures of you doing this, and I kept them for myself.
Yeah.
But I took pictures of you disassembling George and putting him into the box.
Yeah.
And it reminded me of that Twilight Zone where the guy's got the puppet and it keeps talking to him from the crate. You know what I mean?
Cliff Robertson.
Yeah.
I saw that dummy at Copperfield's Museum in Vegas. He has that dummy.
No shit.
Yeah.
Is it as creepy looking in real life?
Yeah, it hasn't even been painted since they shot the Twilight Zone. And his suitcase was there and everything.
Wow.
Fascinated.
Wow. But it was so – it was just so surreal. Like, it, you just see this thing, like, now it doesn't have life anymore, and you're taking
it. Yeah, he dominates me. I'm like kind of a half a person. I'm kind of a – there's nothing to me, and George is the dominant personality.
Well, I don't want to say it.
Yeah.
Well, what I love – one of the things you I see you do a lot on stage is I love that the that George is your – it's like your inner voice, like your insecurities are coming out through him. And the pup – or excuse me, the figure will say to you – it'll say to you in the middle of your set, what are you fucking nervous, you fucking loser? You know what I mean? And it says shit like that. And you're like, Jesus Christ, man. Like
he's – is George like – that's I like that. Is George – like when I'm on stage, when Joe's on stage, I'm like, oh my God, this crowd sucks. But like with you – George gets to look at you and go, this crowd sucks.
Yeah, it's kind of like you not get being to, alone up there, which is kind of
but then you
sick.
Get to be on the side of the crowd and go, come on, these are nice people.
Yeah.
It's like this crazy dichotomy you create. Well, where the dummy will tell you, like, you see the black – why aren't the black people laughing? They stink. And you'd be like, well, why do you get a pick on them,
yeah,
George?
Al Lewis told me that I wasn't talking enough on stage. Grandpa Munster, he goes, why are you even up there? He goes, the dummy's doing like a monologue. There's got to be some conflict. The audience wants to hear from you. So I thought about that because it was Grandpa Munster. It wasn't just some guy. So then, you know, I kind of – I do like the Mike Stivic. George is Archie and I'm Mike Stivic. I try and take the voice of reason, you know. There's got to be a conflict there, you know.
I saw George disassembled when you were a guest on Action. And your episode never aired.
Yeah. And you warned me about that. I remember you told me up front.
And for years, you and I had pseudo-communication because before you could just text and stuff. Yeah. And I felt so bad because you would ask me for the tapes.
Yeah.
And I had no – like I didn't – I wasn't a producer. Right. I was like a hired actor on a show.
Jim Valley was producing, yeah.
And then you would – I think on your end it was, well, why can't Jay just get me these tapes? I don't. And on my end, I'm like, I don't have the tapes.
Yeah.
Like, I would like them for myself because I thought I was pretty good.
I got to spend a day with Buddy Hackett, which was awesome. I got some great photos and got to ask him about Mad, Mad World. That was enough. But, I, you know, I didn't realize when a show ends, it, everything is dismantled and people go their own way. It's not like that.
There's no rear view
action
mirror,
stuff sitting there, you know.
And what's weird is when I saw the dummy or the figure, in you had like a trailer and it said Otto and George. And then he almost looked – when he was disassembled – there was like, there's a lot of like, I guess padding or wraps and stuff, and he almost was dressed like a jockey. There was like, I have this weird memory. Maybe I'm wrong, and I created this in my head. But there was like red and green tape, or like or some kind of wrap, and he got disassembled. And Joe's right; it is a little alarming because I've laughed so hard at the two of you together to just see him as an inanimate object. It's like. Oh, no, 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 no. I need you to look at me and make fun of me when I come up
like
in here.
Yeah, like he's going
to
move. It was weird. When I was in Copperfield's Museum, he has one of my Georges on display there, and he's got all these Jerry Mahoney's and Charlie McCarthy's, and I was the only one still alive in this museum. All the other guys were dead, and I go, wow, one day I'll be dead, and my fucking puppet's going to be sitting there with his eyes open in the Nevada desert in some, you know, fucking magic museum. He was really great, though. He was tired, but he took me there like 2 o'clock in the morning and showed me the whole tour and, you know, told me all about this Houdini. He owns everything. He's got amazing shit down there.
You – we've had a lot of stars on Action. We had a lot of stars. Wait, Sandra Bullock, Tony Hawk. Keanu Reeves was in the pilot. I mean, there was a lot of like massive stars, like A-plus stars. And I will say this. Your – I think it was Full Frontal Comedy on Showtime.
Yeah.
That tape when we got wind – well, I kind of pushed. I wanted you in that scene in the jail cell with Buddy Hackett. That's that tape of you and George made its way around the Culver City Studios lot.
You did?
And by the time – first of all, Buddy Hackett said – it's he was weeping in my trailer and said, that's the funniest 8 minutes I've ever seen in my
that's
life.
Some compliment but he could, from him.
But boy. He could barely say it.
That was the funniest. Oh, my God.
And what? But I will say this to the listeners. For Otto and George on stage, this is a show that Ice Cube, every star in the world was on this show in 8 episodes.
Yeah.
There were 5 times more people to watch George and you.
Wow.
Than there were for Sandra Bullock, Keanu Reeves, you became like this event, like a band that gets hot.
Yeah.
And it's like, how do they sell O2 Arena? What?
It's not cool to be starstruck in L.A., right? It's if you react to a star, you're like lame, right? Isn't that the thing in L.A.?
Yeah, especially on a set. You want to just be like, hey, we're all in this together. Yeah. Welcome. We're all working on the same thing. But for you, everyone lost their minds starstruck because you were the anomaly. Like, I think actors and production people, they're not used to – this is what I said to Patrice. You brought up Patrice earlier. Patrice didn't like the way people were looking at him on The Office.
Oh.
And I was like, but don't you understand when they look at you, they wish they were you because when you leave, you get to go do your own stuff on stage. Like, yeah. You're the anomaly. You're not some douche actor who's like, now I'm just going to go make s'mores with my, you know – indoor fireplace. I got nothing. Like, you get to like then go to the improv and you're and then people adore you again.
Yeah.
And that's all anyone ever wants is attention. That's why we're in show business. But you, everybody, the starstruck thing just went out the window. And I don't know if you remember this.
It did seem like there were a lot of people standing around. And I thought that's what it took to make a show.
No. Yeah. It's literally like a camera op, a guy to push the dolly. No. And it was just you and Buddy Hackett.
I remember the director got pissed at me because I had a cry in a scene with George. And I was having like the greatest day of my life hanging out with Buddy Hackett and having a trailer. And then he got like mad. It's like, this guy can't act. I go, yeah, I'm a nightclub comic. You're not getting Alec Guinness here. And then they sprayed this fucking menthol shit in my eyes to make me tear up like an empty tube with menthol. And I had to hold my eyeballs so my glasses would fucking
– feeding him wasabi.
Yeah.
Oh, that's hilarious.
Yeah, rub wasabi on my eyelids.
It gets worse. Later in the day,
I think the director thought I was a jerk. You know,
you were out of the scene later in the day. They went from you not crying, you getting yelled at by the director. He was a dick.
Yeah,
let's just call it out. Okay. He was a dick. It went from you being told like I kind of need you to cry, and you're like, and it's I can't imagine it's got to be intimidating and embarrassing. Yeah. Like, wow, I'm from where I live in Jersey, and all of a sudden I'm in Hollywood. I'm like, oh, you feel like a jerk. Like, everyone listening, do me a favor. Tell everyone at work today at 3:00, come to my desk. I'm going to cry.
Yeah.
But tell everyone, like, for real. And then when everyone's at your desk, just sit with them and cry and see if you feel like an asshole.
Yeah. I remember the
and there's
scene,
no cameras rolling.
That's hard to do. I can't do that. Can you cry?
I can make you cry in about 2 seconds.
Oh, why would you? Why would you? Can you make yourself cry though in the scene?
You know when I cry off camera when I'm in the scene where I'm supposed to cry for the other person, I bawl my eyes out.
Oh.
And then when the camera's on me, it's so alarming. It's right in front of your face that you just look like a jerk trying to cry.
It's not easy acting. It's a weird thing. You know, I mean, you get a lot of takes, which is cool.
The director descended from you. He descended on you, and then it got worse and worse. He got mad at you for not crying.
Yeah.
And I remember you were very nice. I was like, oh, my God, Otto's going to destroy the guy. And that's when I realized the true dichotomy between man and figure. Like, no, Otto's like this sweet guy.
Yeah.
And George would slam the shit out of him.
Yeah.
But Otto went, okay, I'll do my best. You know, whatever you said to the guy. And they blew menthol in your eyes.
Yeah.
And then they're just showing you Rich Voss's act, just anything to try to get you to weep. And then it got to the point later in the day where it was only the puppet and Buddy Hackett.
Yeah.
And you were behind the bed, on the ground under the bed with just your arm. They got – somehow in the puppet act, they cut out the human.
Yeah.
But you can't work the puppet without the human. So poor Otto is laying under a jail cell bed and they got like a blanket down so you don't see his feet.
Yeah.
And his arm is against the wall working George. So it's just – it degenerates. It's ridiculous.
What was the scene, though?
Buddy Hackett fills a fake prescription for me. He goes, I got to get my hot medicine, P. I got to lose me of my hot. And I go, will you pick me up some Percocet and Valium? He goes, well, this just says hot medicine. And I grab it out of his hand, and I go, and Percocet and Valium. There you go. Fill it. And, and then he goes to fill it, and then cut to, he's in jail, and he's sitting next to George. But all day, it's Otto and George.
Right.
You know?
Right.
And then Otto,
I'm a drunk that's sleeping in the cell, and George is like a separate guy arrested
That's right. They made you just asleep. Okay, you're right.
Yeah.
I oversold it.
Yeah.
They just made you a passed out drunk next to dummy and quickly sort of like made the camera like, here's everyone that's in the holding tank, and now we're just going to focus on these two over here. Like, it's not a ventriloquist act. So
it's
even, I guess it's the highest compliment of how much.
I remember the scene ends with George hanging from Buddy Hackett's belt. And then and I go, why did you do this to George? And he goes, I go, who else in this cell has a size 64 waist? And Buddy Hackett goes, can we change that to 44 waist? I feel fat when you say that. I remember that.
I remember the dummy, yeah. The dummy hung himself.
Yeah.
Yeah, so it's just Otto is asleep on the prison bed. I thought you were under it, like they hid you entirely.
Yeah.
That didn't happen.
No, I remember I shaved for the shoot, and then they put a beard on me because I was supposed to be in jail overnight. So they put a beard on me with this thing.
Yeah, like all of a sudden you're just this hair-suit guy that wolf man.
It was a nice set, though. That jail looked real. It was cool.
They did a good job. Yeah. So he's asleep, and the puppet's working by himself. Mm-hmm. And it never aired.
Yeah.
And we got to figure out a way. Like, if you're on Twitter – at Otto and George, at Jay Mohr. I don't know if you get in touch with Fox.
Were you pretty close to Buddy Hackett? Or
he was like a father to
me. He was, yeah?
Yeah.
That's great.
You know what it is? I met him after I knew everything.
Yeah.
It's like a kung fu story.
Right.
Like I'm a black belt, and then I meet the master, and he's like, when do you take that black belt off and start over? And he just taught me, like, why do you go to the microphone when you go to stay on stage?
Oh.
And I go, because that's where everybody goes. Right. Don't be like everybody. Walk in front of the mic, say hi to a guy in the first row, look in the back and wave. You can't see nobody. They don't know that. Oh. They're like, oh, my God, he's waving to us now, you know. And then if there's a balcony, you point to one guy because he paid for parking. You know, he had a rough day.
Wow.
You know. And then you go behind the microphone, and they all come behind the microphone with you, JJ.
Oh.
Then you're all together. I've never walked behind a mic since.
Wow.
But it is kind of weird at, like, Governors in Levittown to walk in front of the mic
with
your crotch right in front of some Guido in the front row.
He told me that the Music Man was physically the hardest because I was asking about – I wouldn't leave him alone about Mad, Mad World. I just kept fucking obsessing over that one movie. And then he said Music Man was the hardest thing to film. He had to march down the street and, you know, California heat and fucking fat and all –
But, that was written by Meredith Wilson. And it was hard for me, Otto, because I got a 64-inch waist.
Yeah.
But in the further discussion, we'll say 44.
And I said, tell me something about Mad, Mad World that nobody else knows. And he said Mickey Rooney had lost a wife in an OJ-type situation. And one of his wives got murdered by, like, a tennis instructor, killed his wife, ex-wife or something. And he goes, Mickey Rooney came over to his house and said, I want to get drunk. And he wasn't a drinker. So he goes, all right. And he goes, I can't do them as well as you, Jay. And he goes, what are you drinking? He goes, I'll have a Bailey's. And Buddy Hackett goes, well, I'm going to drink scotch. I'll get drunk and you'll get diabetes.
I saw Mickey Rooney at Hackett's funeral, okay?
Uh-huh.
This is one of the most surreal moments of my life. Hackett's funeral, I think it was Forest Lawn. I don't remember what it was. Doesn't matter.
Yeah.
Mickey Rooney comes in with, like, his – I think he's got, like, his wife slash nurse.
Oh.
Like, it's this young shiksa he's rolling with now,
right.
You know? And she's, like, young for him, which is, like, 60 because he's, like, 90. And she's holding his arms walking to where they sit at the funeral.
Right.
Outdoors. Oh, it's blazing ass hot. It's, like, 100 degrees. It's awful. And I'm like, this is not a place for a guy that old. And he's completely invalid, right?
Yeah.
Like, he's doing, like, the dwarf walk with his little feet. Like, he can barely move.
Wow.
And then they just decide it's time to go. And halfway through the funeral, they stand up, Mickey Rooney and his, like, handler woman. And he, like, kind of brushes her off, like, get the hell away from me, like, it kind of mean.
Yeah.
And then you saw, like, the evolution of man, like a little crippled old man walk towards the casket. And as he came down the aisle, he got super straight up, like, at attention almost.
Wow.
And the last, like, 20 feet, he walked like a fucking man.
Wow.
Completely with it. And he walked right up to the casket and went, mwah, and blew it a kiss. And a big salute, like he was in the army. And the girl walked towards him, and he waved her off, like, get the hell away from me. And he walked down the steps by himself, like he was 30 years old.
Wow.
And then when they got to the car, he just went, beep, beep.
Jeez.
But he knew, like, the greatest showbiz moment of his life at that time.
Yeah, he's still performing.
I'm not going to be an old man in front of Hackett.
Yeah.
But just to watch him march
was
down.
Was it a sad kind of funeral? Buddy Hackett was kind of old.
It was great.
Yeah.
It was really great because his rabbi was really funny. Like, Hackett loved his grandkids so much, and Hackett said to his rabbi, what is it that I love grandkids so much? And the rabbi says, common enemy. You both can't stand your kids.
That's great.
Uh, there's a lot of legendary stories about you and George. Okay.
Uh-huh.
And with all puppet acts, you guys all seem to wind up at some point, whether it's urban legend or not, wind up arguing with one another when you don't think anyone's watching.
Well, I do that now to carry it off. I'll have a fight with George as I'm walking off this after doing a set, just so people think that there's that Twilight Zone component, that I have an offstage life where I'm a tortured guy and a dummy, you know, who's fucking yelling at me and stuff. That's not at all real.
You've even like in a drug haze, you never just sat there and argued with George.
No, I don't think so. I don't take him out unless I'm being paid, you know.
What made you? I've always wondered this about guys that do what you do. What attracted you to it initially?
He just said it was the first question.
When?
About Paul Winchell? Well, I was
Paul Winchell.
No. I mean, come on, that's not what I mean.
If I yell at you, tell me you won't smash me when he comes up.
Not what I mean, but I mean, like, what was it? You talked about who influenced you and what you like, but there's something so different about this versus saying, I want to get up on stage and just be funny.
Yeah.
You know, there's something that attracts a juggler to juggling. It's a very specific thing, even though we're all in stage performance. Like, but what was it about having
My 7-year-old brain was fascinated by those puppets, and I had to know how they worked. Because you never saw what he was doing back there, so I wanted to see for myself what mechanics were in there. It took me years to finally get a professional doll. I was only able to get a Jerry Mahoney with the string in the back of the head. That's just what I wanted to do. I decided, almost immediately that it's what I wanted to do. And I was working pretty fast after that. I was doing like birthday parties and camp shows and stuff like that.
Yeah, I mean, it's incredible. I watched that Elmo documentary, Elmo, whatever. It's like that guy, I mean, from the time he talks about when he saw Sesame Street when he was like 6 or whatever, and he literally said he was looking at the TV going, I want to do that.
Yeah.
Like, I want to be was more fascinated by being a puppeteer and then slowly got into the
You
voice
never wanted
work
to do it alone by yourself?
No, I mean, I only went into the clubs because you couldn't street perform in the winter in New York. I went out to California. And I got the guy I was with, a magician, got arrested because it was another guy, this black dude, Chris Capehart. We were misinformed that street performing was encouraged in L.A. It was Venice Beach, and we just set up somewhere in Los Angeles, and he got arrested immediately. So in the winter, a street performer has no place to perform. So then the improv and catch were available. I started going to those places.
But you always wanted to go – you were drawn first to ventriloquism. You never thought, I, Otto Petersen, want to go up on stage and be funny and just do it by myself.
No, I didn't think I had what it takes to do that. I didn't have enough of perspective. I mean, I was – Joe knows everything about stand-up. We were talking a lot about stand-up. I always liked the clowns, the Abbott and Costellos and those guys. I liked the physical comics as a kid. That's what fed me.
Well, that's interesting because I think that a lot of those guys from that era, the Abbott and Costello era, I think all of them either played off of a straight man or their comedy relied on people reacting to it in some way.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? There was nothing – like a clown can't be a loner really. There's got to be the other person there.
That's true.
Do you know what I'm saying?
Two-man dialogue. Yeah, the straight man always got more money in those days. Abbott got 60 and he got 40 even when they were doing movies.
Yeah, exactly.
That was some weird tradition because there was no shortage of – fat little comedians, but there was a shortage of good straight men back then.
Right. And yeah, I was watching something about Lucille Ball where she was talking to Buster Keaton.
Yeah.
She worked with Buster Keaton and he talked about where the clowns and everything. And it's like, it makes sense. It's like if Lucille didn't have Desi, it stinks.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean?
He brought a lot to that show. He brought sex appeal. He brought music.
Yeah,
that show was horrible without Desi on his. Horrible.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You need him there going, what the fuck are you doing? You know what I mean?
Lucy, why you do to your face?
Yeah.
It is weird, like the clown dynamic, and you're a straight man on stage, but you're a straight man with an inanimate object.
Yeah.
And so you have a secondary, a third, and a fourth job. You got to bring him to life. You have to get a reaction from the crowd through him. You have to apologize for him.
Thanks for recognizing all that. I really appreciate it. Most people just go, his fucking lips are moving. He sucks. Let's go see Jeff Dunham now. They just judge me on that one fucking thing. I could do it without moving my lips. It's just too much fucking pressure. You know, I can't enunciate enough. I'd rather be heard.
I'm telling you, Colin and I sat and spoke for on More Stories for like 30 minutes about you and the genius of what it takes to pull that show off. And I'm glad you're here because I think it's time. I mean, look, everyone loves Otto and George, but I mean, I hate to break it to you. There's no George.
No.
Go in your sock drawer and look at your goddamn underwear. Same thing.
Yeah.
All right? Take off one of your shoes, hold it in your hand. That's George.
Right, right.
It's nothing. The only thing that makes it great is the eyebrows go up, which is my personal favorite.
Yeah.
I love when he just feigns disgust and his eyebrows go up.
I think there's even I think there's even
I don't feel that.
Another layer to what you're saying about him having the being the straight man to an inanimate object. I think in most acts that are similar to what you do, I think the figure gets the laughs a lot. But in your act, even though the figure is the guy getting the laughs, I almost think he's the straight man because you're the butt of all the jokes.
Yeah.
That he's looking at you. He's Bud Abbott. He's looking at you going, what the fuck is wrong with you, stupid shit? You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Language.
And I'm sorry. I get passionate about this.
Yeah.
But you know what I'm saying? Even though you don't have as many of the literal punchlines as he does, you're still
– I mean, not as much. It's like 95 to 5. Would you agree?
95 to 5
punchlines. Like you give all of them to George.
Yeah, completely. When I tell a joke, it just lays there dead, you know.
And the best is I love when George, when you make George, like I said, if Joe DeRosa at Joe DeRosa Comedy, because Joe DeRosa's taken, whatevs.
Yeah.
At complete my song. And I'm at jmore37. Oh, by the way, I'm supposed to say this. Don't forget to go to jmore.com, click the Amazon banner, and buy something on Amazon through my website. That's the way to do it. That's how we all get paid. And that's how we can afford to get George a new denim jacket. How creepy is that to be buying clothing for a figure?
A lot of people give me clothes. I still don't know what size he is. Yeah, it is weird. And then you have to slash a big hole in the back to stick my hand in. Yeah.
So you've never been to, like, Baby Gap? Like, that looks nice.
What I'm wearing? Oh.
So you are, buddy. For George.
Yeah, I guess so. I mean, only women notice that. Oh, you changed his outfit. Guys don't give a fuck. I had a Yankee uniform on George for 20 years and never changed it. Smelled. But women notice that. If you change the sneakers, they'll react to it. Girls.
I guess that's all we ever want.
People, they notice they're aesthetically different. You know, they'll watch a porno movie and be like looking at a lamp in the corner and thinking that's going to be good in our house, you know.
I like that through the years, George has steadfastly refused to change from his Gene Simmons hair.
Oh.
I always say he looks like Dennis Miller after a fire.
Really? The black hair? Yeah.
But I love when you – like I was saying, if me and Joe DeRosa are on stage and we're eating it, we can't go, what the fuck's wrong with you guys? Like, yeah. I know this is funny. You saw, but like George can just – you make George pile it all on you. Like you'll say something like to set up George and George – I've seen George look at you and go, ever notice every time you talk the show sucks?
I actually get physically –
You half Danish Jew junkie. Sweat out the drugs.
After a lot of that, I feel it's just like, you know, when you do positive things to yourself and you cheer up, it's actually hurts me after a while. I feel depressed and like a loser, you know.
But you're the one saying it.
Yeah, but it's still if you just sit there and go, you're a loser, and your posture is going to change and you're going to get depressed.
Feeds into the point I'm making.
Yeah.
You're the one thinking it, making the dummy say it back to you.
Yeah.
So you think it, and then you have the dummy, the figure, say it out loud back at you. So what's going – like if I'm on stage going, I suck. This is terrible. This is an off night.
There's
got to
be some schizophrenia that's crept in through the years. But I wasn't initially like, you know, two different personalities or anything like that. But I guess it's somehow manifested itself.
I've heard you a lot on Opie and Anthony when you're just alone.
Yeah.
And you are really funny.
Oh.
But there's no – you have no desire to go out on stage.
Aren't there enough stand-ups for Christ's sake now?
Yeah, but if you need to do it, you need to do it. Yeah. There's a lot of fucking crackheads out there, but some of us feel the need to go out and cook dope.
Do I have any desire to do an act by myself? No.
Okay.
Yeah.
And when you make George mock you, some of it is, you know, in the moment and quick. And I gotta just say, it's brilliant. I remember once I watched you at the Laugh Factory. And if you ever watch Otto and George mm-hmm. in Fast Forward on a DVD, like times two or times four the speed, it's really just a really fast 4-minute video of Otto pulling George by the jacket. Yeah. Like, come on, take it easy. Come on, Otto, calm down now. Yeah, calm down.
I do that a lot.
And then, but I saw you once and you said, I don't know, it was about just something about, you know, vaginas or whatever. And then you said, all right. Like, you wanted to move on.
No.
And then about two jokes later, you made George look at you and go,
all right.
And it freaked me out because it was like the amount – like
the time delay of it. Yeah.
Yeah, it's brilliant. That's like what fascinated me and Colin and Joe. Like there's so – I don't think people realize – it's like, hey, he's a puppet act. What's the big deal? He's a puppet act and he swears. You don't realize the amount – the technical aspect that goes into pulling that off. Otherwise, you just suck.
Well, Billy Hayesfeld told me that story when you and Billy and Otto and George were all in O&A together.
And oh, my God. Yeah. By the way, have you ever been blown this long?
No, this is good. I feel like Joe's being neglected.
In case George came out, I had George here so you could slam him instead of me.
Oh, okay.
I'm like, when do you bring George? I'll bring DeRosa. He's half Egyptian. And he goes, oh, okay, yeah. I can work with that.
Is that really why I'm here?
Yes.
You fucking asshole.
Yeah. Well, I needed a third mic. Sorry. In case if George comes out, he's just sitting across from me. Then, you know how weird it is? If it's just Otto looking me in the eye after this discussion, and then George is slamming me, and I'm like, Otto, I know it's you.
Yeah.
Like, what you just said, there's truth to that. We just talked about it for a half
but
hour.
I just feel like now I feel like
you're on a podcast. At the end of 250,000 people at Joe DeRosa Comedy. Cheer up.
Thank you.
Jesus Christ. We have more listeners than Piers Morgan. You're whining.
Who's Piers Morgan?
Exactly. Oh. CNN. So, the British guy that replaced Larry King.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
What happened to Larry King?
I retired.
Oh.
As for my money, beets are a great vegetable. This is hard-hitting news. Push-ups are hard.
So,
all right, yeah. So we're at Opie and Anthony.
You're at Opie and
Anthony.
You want
it?
I was not on the show that day.
All right, so let me tell
But the story?
Well, can I have it?
You can have it, dude.
Right.
I'm serious.
Because I don't want to correct you if anything goes south and look like a jerk. So let me just do this.
No. I was there. Yeah.
You were talking to us back in the NEW days of Opie and Anthony. Our buddies, Opie and Anthony. Okay, terrific. they're on XM, Sirius, Satellite Radio, opieandanthony.com. What?
Yeah. All right, why don't you just blow everybody until you take this stuff?
You were talking to Opie. There's a New York – now, listener, you got to picture this. Otto is just a regular, handsome-looking guy, like just a guy. He's not like a fat slob. He's just like a regular, like good-looking guy.
Yeah.
He's just sitting there having a conversation with Opie. Like they're actually talking about like the day's events.
Right.
The New York Post is open. The radio stations have those giant counters.
Yeah.
The New York Post is open, and there's something about Madonna in the New York Post. As Otto is talking to Opie, you got to – no, just hang in there with me and picture this, listeners. Otto is talking to Opie. Like they're having a full conversation about, I don't know, taxes in Long Island or funding Nassau Coliseum to bring back the island or something. That's
right.
For real.
Right.
As they're talking, George is looking down at the Post intermittently going, yeah, mm-hmm.
Ugh, Madonna's a hoo-ha.
Yeah. But Otto never stopped. There was a complete disconnect between you and the figure. Then in the middle of the conversation, I look at Opie and I make a gesture towards George like, this is like an other level happening that we're watching. We're watching someone actually.
I wanted to see if anybody would pick up on that. You know?
We picked up on it. Opie and I always do like this eye contact thing. Like if a guest sucks, we'll look at each other and go like, oh. But like no one else can catch it because it's too mean.
Yeah.
And I look at Opie like, this is amazing. So Opie picks up on it. And I'll give Opie credit. As far as silent communication, he's way up there, bro.
Yeah, he's very good.
And I look at Opie like, are you getting this just with my eyes? And so Opie goes, now hold on. Hold on a second, George, and immediately the figure looks up and goes, yes, sir. And Billy Hayes and me had to leave the studio because it was one of those laughs that you're going to be like, my spleen's going to break. I don't know if you ever laugh so hard that you actually have to leave the room. Like, you have to, like if you got food in your mouth, but like no food in your mouth. It was the craziest, most insane. And I didn't know if you weren't well. I didn't know if I wasn't well.
Yeah.
You took the space-time continuum and just threw it away. Oh. But now you're saying you do that on purpose.
Yeah, to see if anybody will pick up on that. Or why have the dummy at all? Why do an act, you know?
But this is an important podcast, I think, now. Yeah. Like, this is better than if we just sat here with George and he called him an Egyptian, you know, homo or something. Because this is – Look, people on Twitter, as soon as you and I started touching each other up on Twitter, at Otto and George and OttoandGeorge.com, as soon as you and I started, you know, trading paint on Twitter, people immediately were like, oh, my God, you got to get him on the podcast. Well, I don't know if George is going to come out and call us our mother's twats, but this is way more interesting to me. And I, you know what? If there's an hour – whose phone is that?
Oh.
I'm kidding. If there's – I don't really care. This is laid back, as you can tell. Exactly. If there's an hour of a podcast where you just finally Otto Petersen can get all the credit coming to him, then so be it.
Great.
George can sit in his stupid box with this fragile sticker.
I would have gone to LA to do this thing, Jay.
All right.
How long are you in this hotel for? Is it weird living in the – this is pretty comfortable.
Is it weird?
Yeah.
I pick up the phone. They come make my bed.
Yeah, it's great.
What's weird about it?
What are you here for, like a month?
Yeah. I'll owe money when I
leave. Are you in New York because you like New York in this time of the year, or is it just doing some gigs? Or?
A lot of gigs. I had Wilbur Theater, Borgata. Borgata actually got literally wiped out.
Yeah.
And then Gotham, Governors in Levittown, a corporate gig last night. I'm going to Philly to do a prostate benefit. Prostate can't. It'd be weird if there was a benefit for prostates. Like, we need a benefit for us.
So the Borgata is not open now?
It's open now, but they're scrambling because there's people like Tony Bennett and Chaka Khan. You got to kind of have to work around their schedules.
Oh, okay.
And then the comics come in. That's the weirdest thing about playing a casino is like when you get paid, you go in the office and you're between like Al Green and Tony Bennett. And you're like, what?
Really?
Yeah.
You mean standing there?
No, on the – no, you're an idiot. You had us both. You did a good job.
Yeah,
you're a good,
good
actor, Joe.
Thank you. You can't cry though.
I can't either.
Yeah.
It's hard to cry, as you learned.
Yeah. You know, so that director was a dick. It wasn't me. I thought I was an amateur. I am an amateur actor. I have no fucking experience.
We're all amateur actors.
Yeah.
You know why? Because we do it as kids for free. When we're children on the playground, you go, hey, let's do – huh?
I can always make you cry.
Yeah, she's a great – she can cry instantly.
Yeah.
She can do like a single tear like Denzel.
Wow.
I mean, you have to take her shirt off and whip her.
Yeah. Denzel? Is he – you consider him a good actor? Tell him 1, 2, 3 was shit.
We love him.
We're just kind of the same.
Yeah.
Her and Denzel are always up for the same thing. My man.
I think he's a good actor. Somebody once pointed out all his tricks to me, though.
Tricks?
And then it kind of ruined it.
Really? Yeah. Like the laugh. What do you mean tricks? Like
he always goes, Otto Petersen. All right, all right.
Oh, yeah.
That's what you're telling me. That's what you're telling me, right? You tell him you got the figure in the box. You're going to take him out. You're going to make him tuck.
Yeah.
You're going to take him out. That's what you're telling me, right?
That Pelham 1-2-3 was just garbage. Fucking, they didn't even use Gandolfini, and he's a terrific actor.
You know,
I like Denzel a lot.
I'm on the fence with Dick Gandolfini. Every role he does, these voices, and I'm like, I don't know if I'm buying it or not.
Yeah,
voices like Tigger. Well, he sounds like this every time I hear him.
Yeah,
that sounded like
when you hear him talk as the person that he is, it's weird. It's like he's not Tony Soprano.
I don't know if I wasn't a big Sopranos fan.
Yeah.
All right. You know what? I can't even talk to you.
I love that show. I thought it was a great –
I wasn't a big Soprano fan. What do you like? The irony douche in Brooklyn with the mustache with the cool record collection? You know, I really wasn't into Sopranos.
Yeah.
Because I don't have a TV.
What show is that? What are you talking about?
Sopranos?
No, I did – I thought that the
– Here's the mic. There's your mouth.
Jesus.
The guy's across the room. I got to get a boom up.
Breaking my balls today. I didn't like The Sopranos. I'm entitled to that opinion.
Yeah, you are, for sure.
I mean, I hate MASH.
Yeah.
I felt The Sopranos was a cartoonish representation of the Italian culture.
Are you Italian?
Yes.
So you would,
and we don't talk like that. We don't walk around going, "Hey, the fuck did we got?"
It was ridiculous.
So was
Goodfellas. The real guys that they're depicting, you wouldn't want to see what they do to the, you know,
Goodfellas
when they're doing
is great. I'll tell you the most realistic.
That's
one.
That's a cartoon, also.
No, a real mafioso
is not funny like Joe Pesci. He's not cute. He doesn't have one-liners. Just a murderer. You wouldn't want to see that.
Donnie Brasco was the best interpretation of any.
Pacino
of it.
Was.
It was so real because it was like low rent.
It was great to see him playing a low-level thug and not a boss.
It was a punch.
Yeah, he was great in
what
that.
About Chef
yeah,
Man?
I'm not a.
He was awesome.
And
in
then
that.
All these guys from The Sopranos, like they're just still hanging around. Like they turn up in all these detergent commercials.
Yeah,
you know, I ain't no wise guy with my laundry.
I'm the voice of the lemon.
Yeah, it's just I don't
but
know.
Don't fault them for parlaying being. A, you know, you got to keep in mind, Joe. Let me tell you how showbiz works. You got to keep in mind. These guys were number 11 on the call sheet of the greatest show of its era. And then when they got done with James Gandolfini, Edie Falco, and then when they filmed everyone else, they went, okay, Sharippo, we got about 10 minutes. Why don't you just say your lines?
Really?
So if that guy can parlay that into, you know, doing his thing,
I guess
have at it.
You could also just work harder.
you mean they're not versatile? I know you're saying they're not versatile actors, and
I'm just saying
when I got a sore throat, I use chloroseptic.
Yeah,
you know what I mean? And my throat feels better.
It's what I mean. It's just annoying after a while. It's like all right, I get it. Like you guys aren't real mobsters. It's like I'm just getting sick of it. That show that Van Zant did afterwards was a
Lilyhammer.
Lilyhammer. It's embarrassing.
He plays Syl transported to Norway. It's great, though, because he brings all his mafia. Did you think that
like
sucked?
Witness I thought it was program? Like laughable.
What's that?
Was he in like the witness protection program?
Yeah, exactly. He had to leave for a hit or something.
No,
yeah.
I thought it was laughably
bad. It's
a
great wig they put on him.
It was pretty bad, but just to watch him as an actor, I guess I'm more forgiving. I just like to watch him as an actor. I got into it.
Just the whole like this thing, and you can't see this at home, unfortunately, but this thing, the...
Yeah.
You know, they all do that. Their shoulders are up around their ears.
Stick the bottom lip out.
Yeah, the bottom lip's out. Hey, man, are you fucking money
took
gun?
Me a while
gonna,
to
it's like, stop it. It's like ridiculous looking to me, you know?
It took me a while to get in over the Syl, the cartoonishness of Syl's character, but I started to like him after a couple of years. I thought that show was amazing.
I lived on Spring Street in Thompson for, 8 years?
Yeah.
And, you know, that's when the chin, Gigante, was walking around the village in his robe and making believe he was crazy, so he didn't have to go to jail. You saw him every day. And when you walk by the social club on Sullivan Street, that's exactly what, like, there's always one guy with a geranium on his head with his shoulders up like that.
Really?
And there's always, like, just a guy that looks completely regular. And I'm going to tell you this. I'm not saying what you're saying is wrong, Joe DeRosa, at Joe DeRosa Comedy, at Otto and George. But but when they Jersey Shore came out and people lost their minds, like, this is not fair to the people of Jersey. Like, fuck you. I went to public school in New Jersey, and I got beat up every day by Ronnie, by the situation. That's exactly who was in my high school.
I think that show was for people who were in
That's all there is.
I think that show existed for people that were in Sopranos withdrawal after that went off the air. The Jersey
Shore. But I'm saying Jersey Shore is even more... Jersey Shore is a closer representation of the people I grew up with.
Yeah,
that were Italian.
Well, I'm in no way saying, oh, I don't like The Sopranos because I feel it's an unfair representation. I could give a fuck about my ethnicity at all.
Language. Yeah,
but what I am saying is, and look, there were some great actors. I think Edie Falco is tremendous.
Yeah,
that's the thing about the Joe, guy that he played goes the, way out. To you know, no one has Edie.
Yeah,
the guy that played the nephew, I think is great. Frank Vincent, fucking awesome.
Yeah,
there's some great guys in the show. And I'm not saying I don't think Gandolfini's a shitty actor.
Yeah,
I just didn't think. You know, the argument I always got from that show was you go, I don't like Sopranos, and then people go, why? You go, because this season stinks. And they go, well, this season and the last season stunk, and the one before that stunk. Seasons 1 and 2 were great, and then it got good halfway through the last season.
No one said that.
It's like that's a shit ratio for a TV show.
No one said that.
There were those two seasons where he was having the dream sequences with the Russian girl.
There was only one episode.
The last season.
There was only one episode with a long dream sequence.
With the Buddhist monks, and they followed him around.
Well, that was a coma. I don't consider that a dream
sequence.
That last sequence.
Episode yeah. was, oh, yeah, yeah, was yeah. like kind of whatever.
All right, all right.
Well, yeah, but that was a that was a classic David Chase thing in The Sopranos that to leave it, what do they call it, up to you, you know, whether he's killed or not. And then in every season, the second to last episode was really violent and had a good body count. And
that
the
was
last
good.
Episode was always more about family. So it was in that tradition of the show.
I'm going to take a ton of heat for this on Twitter.
All my friends
for
loved
what?
It.
Because people are just tell you you're an idiot.
Yeah.
I don't think I'm an idiot. I think I got a really valid argument here.
You're an intellectual, and you let the listeners know that you think Edie Falco is a good actress. That's mighty wide.
She is. Hey, she's got a new hit TV show.
Yeah, and we all know it. That's why it's like, you know, this De Niro kid. Keep an eye on him.
Yeah.
You know?
Well, no, I'm not saying it.
You're yelling at me.
I'm not saying it.
What are we, the game?
Because the mic's fucking 3 feet away from us.
What are we, at Van Halen with Gary Cherone?
I'm not saying it like that. Like, you know, Edie Falco is good. She's got my butt. What I'm saying is, so you don't think I'm a moron. I think Edie Falco is a good actor.
Tony!
I think there are a lot of good actors on the show. I'm not including her and some other people when I say, oh, I couldn't stand all these people going around with their shoulders up.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's
all right, let me tell you something.
Yeah.
There are five shows in our lifetime. Everyone in this room, there are five shows in our lifetime that matter.
Yeah.
You can count them. Sopranos, The Wire, what else?
You know, a lifetime.
Mad Men.
Mad Men is way
never,
up
never
there.
Seen
I might
that
put
one.
Mad Men up top.
Never
actually.
Seen that one.
I might put Mad Men on top of all of them.
Lost, I would say, was. Was
you know what?
Look, I'm not a fan.
Really?
Hold on a second. I'm
There's
not a
fucking smoke monster.
Hold on a second. I'm not a fan.
He wasn't kidding. It made it funnier that he was serious. Yeah. I thought you were making a joke.
No.
I know. Mad Men, The Wire, Sopranos, and Joe goes, Lost.
Don't I'm forget not a fan, Lost. But everybody was talking about that
Small Wonder.
Show.
What about that little robot
yeah,
girl?
Yeah, yeah,
in the
yeah.
house. Little Wonder, Vicky, Small Wonder.
Everybody talked about that fucking show for years, Lost. People wouldn't shut the fuck up about
no,
it.
No, I'm talking about shows that actually are – they transcend television – and they were super – it's important. Like, The Sopranos was an actual – like, these were people that lived. Like, you never thought – like, J.J. from Good Times walks in. There's a laugh track. It's a thing. And that's one of the great – or Sanford and Son, one of the best shows of all time. Or even MASH, which neither one of you like.
No.
These are seminal shows, huge shows.
Yeah.
But you knew it was a put-on. You knew you were – you knew it wasn't a real operating room. But The Sopranos, it was appointment television. You had to get home
because yeah, exactly.
it was starting.
Yeah.
And if you missed it, you missed out.
Yeah.
It felt like a put-on to me, man. I didn't think it was anywhere near as believable as Goodfellas, Godfather, Donnie Brasco, The Sicilian. I mean, I can name a million fucking mob movies that I thought did it. Better.
We're talking
I mean,
about.
The analyzed disc was more believable.
Yeah,
no, I'm
you're
kidding.
Missing
I'm
point.
Joking.
The Sopranos was a comedy, you know, set in a, in, you know,
yeah,
with drama components.
Was it a comedy?
I looked at it as a comedy.
I laughed my balls
me?
Off at it. But I got to interrupt Otto and go back to Joe. Like, you mentioned movies. See,
right.
Your own argument against is an argument for that you took the greatest mob movies
right.
and you're holding a weekly television show in that category with mob movies. It's not a mob movie, Joe. It's a series that every week you had to get new characters in and out. How do we cover her being gone? What do we do with the Russian guy that ran into the woods?
Yeah.
What, don't get cunty, Chrissy.
Yeah.
You know, like there were so
Chrissy.
Many moving parts. You know what I mean? In a movie, it's based on a book. You write it, you film it, it's done. The Sopranos was like this amorphous moving thing that lived, and we all watched it live, and we didn't feel like it was a put-on. We were eavesdropping on this real thing that was going on.
And you're going to tell me that it is not the common belief of the fan base of this show that there were at least three doozy seasons of this show.
Absolutely not. I will say
Come on.
A season – And you're telling me the listeners are more stories.
Well, I don't know about the listeners in particular. I'm talking about
that's
the
what you just said.
No, the fan, no. The fans of the show mean the Sopranos. I'm sorry, I didn't mean of more stories specifically.
I think people are super mad at the way it ended, but 5-6 years later, we all talk about it. So apparently, David Chase is a genius because we're all sitting around going, "That was really weird that ending."
And that's like saying
I know
that the Attack of the Clones was brilliant because we're still talking about. What a letdown of a Star Wars movie it was. It wasn't brilliant. Some of us liked it, some of us didn't. But it did not live up to the caliber that it should have at the end of the day. And the last episode of The Sopranos, I'm sorry, ended with a fucking film school trick. Oh, I'm going to build a little bit of tension, then I'm just going to do the cut to black.
Yeah.
I mean, that is freshman year short film shit.
Because
life goes on. It's the same thing they did in Barfly. It starts the same way it ends. Life goes on. Nothing changes.
Yeah, I agree with that. But, I mean,
let Otto talk.
If he had ended, with the machine gun that Bacala gave him, just mowing down people and then getting shot, it would have been a weird way to end that.
But it shouldn't.
Nobody wanted to see him die.
I'm not saying it had to end like that.
Yeah.
That's not what I'm saying at all.
Yeah.
What I'm saying is, you bring up a great point with Barfly, okay? Yeah. It ends the way it begins. So does Waiting for Godot. And when you watch either of those things, you're not sitting there going, what a fucking jip. That show could have ended the way it begun, but it was executed poorly. It was not executed in a cinematic or interesting fashion. It was cheap, man.
Let me say this.
Been 10 minutes watching the chick park the fucking car, and it's like, okay, that created a little tension.
I got you.
But it's stupid.
David Chase only directed two episodes, the first one and the last one.
It was all Van Patten after that.
Yeah, it was all Timmy other Van guys. Patton. What about Boardwalk Empire?
When Dick Van Patten directed, the show was very shaky.
I thought all the Van Pattens were the same bloodline.
They are.
Oh, they are?
I want to say this real quick. I think your argument works against you, and that is that David Chase created something so perfect, there is no way to end it.
Oh, come on. Come on.
We're going to take a commercial. What? We'll be right back with Joe. No. No commercials.
What?
What's up, Joe?
The Sopranos is the reason why all the cable networks have phenomenal shows that people flock to. Because before that, there was really no show.
Joe, Otto's friend Joe's a great point.
Yeah.
If it wasn't for The Sopranos, we wouldn't be watching Dexter because The Sopranos made cable television a destination. If you like your movie Oscar-winning people on television, you can thank The Sopranos.
I'd like them to get the fuck off of television. Make room for guys like me. You don't make fucking movies, you cocksuckers.
No one else feels that way, Joe.
Yeah, I know. So can we talk about figures more? The Shield. I mean, there are other shows. I'm not saying that the show has not had a cultural impact. I'm not arguing that point.
Yeah.
I'm not saying that it was groundbreaking in certain ways. I think there were many other shows that are involved in that. I think The Shield was a crucial show. I mean, that was FX's big thing when they first came around. But all I'm saying about The Sopranos is I was not a fan of the show. And I don't think it's as good as everybody says it is. I think it's very, very overrated.
You know, said The Godfather and Goodfellas, like, that's what the mafia is overrated. What they really like. They're not like that. The guy that Don Corleone was based on murdered a guy. He went to the guy's wedding, murdered him because he wanted to fuck his wife, and then later on fucked the guy's wife. That's what they're not like. These righteous
that happened with Crazy Horse.
Mafioso guys.
Well, I don't think they – look, I think the – I know, it did. It did, actually.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, it's where we talked about
Have you
about
seen
that.
The movie Magic 1,000 times?
Not to sound stupid, but the book was way better because in the book you didn't know that he was a vent. And it was just a – you know
event,
he did
is
some –
that industry speak for ventriloquist?
Yeah, ventriloquist. Okay. He's always talking to this guy Fats. You know he does something in the entertainment world, and it's revealed halfway through the book that he's a fucking insane ventriloquist with a demonic puppet. And you couldn't do that in the movie. So the movie went from the first chapter to the last two chapters just to see Anne Margaret naked in the woods there. So the book was fantastic. The movie, not so good.
Yeah, but the book doesn't have Anthony Hopkins.
No. I mean, it's early Anthony Hopkins, and it's great, and I love Burgess Meredith's scenes, but it wasn't what it, I don't think they've done the definitive crazy vent movie yet.
You know what I love about that movie is that Anthony Hopkins plays the son of an American, and he still has his English accent.
Yeah.
Like, that guy won't drop that fucking accent for shit, man.
No.
Because he's fancy.
He's playing Alfred Hitchcock now. I saw some pictures of him doing like a screen test.
Yeah.
It looks really good.
It does. I really like the HBO movie they just did about Hitchcock.
Yeah, that guy was great.
Toby Jones. That guy's
Toby Jones played Capote.
Oh,
he can only
great.
Play effeminate bald men, apparently.
Oh, yeah.
He also played Donald Rumsfeld.
That's right.
Yeah, he's great, man. That
like I said,
great.
Effeminate bald man.
Yeah.
All right. Don't make a big deal out of it, DeRosa. Yeah. You're the wind beneath my wings, et cetera.
That's great.
Is there a resentment? Do you ever have a resentment that you have to go on stage with a figure?
No, but carrying the trunk through Midtown was kind of a fucking inconvenience. I was enjoying my couch time today. Like, I got to do Jay Mohr. No, I went to bed with my toes tapping under the sheets knowing I was going to see you today.
Can we just isolate that to put in the opening credits? I went to bed with my toes tapping under the sheet. You sound like Chris Sarandon. You want to talk to him? To him. He'll kill me.
You're killing everybody else, Leon.
So you never look at the puppet as like – you never loathe
I
or
envy
hate.
That a comic could just walk in with his mouth and, you know, just just to their body and their brain and do a set. Now you got to carry that thing around. It's a pain in the ass to travel with, you know.
But you never look at him alone in your house and go, ugh.
And resent that he's getting –
resent that you got to lug him around. He gets all the laughs.
No, I mean, this is the business I chose.
Here, I've never complained.
Yeah.
Someone put a bullet in his eyebrow.
Business.
Yeah.
Michael. Here's the thing, though, also is I guess a better way to tee up the question for you is I don't think I know, and Joe knows, and that Joe knows, and you know. It would be great if, like, for 20 minutes, I'm like, and Anthony knows, and Jimmy knows, and Club Soda Kenny knows.
And then you forgot what you had to say.
Our shadows move around us, going through the fucking window. This guy loses 4 pounds of sweat heat.
Time to lab some of that.
Like, we know how much work goes into everyone thinking it's just a puppet act. Like, the effortlessness to watch it is effortless.
Well, the tradition was to wear black so your eye would be drawn to the doll. But on TV, you're judged a lot harsher. The few times I've been on TV, they just stare at my technique and try and see movement, you know.
Because your lips do move.
Yeah, but not always. If you see some of my specials, I mean, my spots or whatever you call them, I did my technique, you know, right. So, but what's the difference? It's more impressive that they think George is real and my lips are moving at the same time. That's more of an achievement, you know.
How many buttons and levers and knobs are actually inside the back of the figure?
There's the mouth, the eyebrows, the eyes moving side to side, and the winkers, four.
What a winker. Oh, like a wink.
Closing
blinks?
His eyes. And then the Kennedy is just to jerk him forward and stop short, and the wig flies up. But that brain I have in there is an actual realistic depiction of how much of his skull was missing on the real Kennedy's autopsy. A third of his skull was gone. It was this much brain was showing.
Jesus Christ. What's great about that bit, aside from everything, is when you put George on your lap, one leg over each side, the puppet goes, "My balls, you asshole!
Yeah.
Side saddle, motherfucker!" And then the audience actually goes, "Ooh!" Like he hurt his balls. Like you really. Completely convince everybody.
And I do the actual assassination. Governor Connolly's wife said to Kennedy, they're all applauding. She goes, "Well, you can't say the people of Dallas don't love you." And that was the last exchange.
No, you certainly can't.
He was like, yeah, bang. And then he was dead. So I do that.
Jesus Christ.
Yeah,
really?
That was the last thing he said. Yeah.
I never knew that.
Yeah.
And Miller-esque, you're the only guy that could do a Kennedy assassination and immediately segue into a Cy Sperling Hair Club for Men bit. Somehow, you ever seen him do that?
No.
The puppet has his head flopped over and his hair's in his eyes and his brain's all over the front row.
Yeah.
And then he just turns the puppet around with that awful, his hair is hanging in his eyes. Not only am I the hair club president, I'm also a client. Like, that's Dennis Miller level segue. It's awesome.
Dennis Miller and me worked together, but I don't remember him. But this club called Good Times. He remembers everything about me. I don't remember
everything about you.
I don't remember
you,
working with him.
Yeah, you're a hard guy to forget. That Dennis Miller is easy to forget, but I mean, I think you tend to remember a guy with a thing on his lap saying cunt to people. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
I saw you at Caroline's, and it was Fleet Week. And all the Navy people filled Caroline's on the random, like, Tuesday night.
Yeah, yeah.
And for some reason, Otto Petersen Heaven, the entire first three rows were black women in uniform. Like, you must have walked on stage like, oh, my God, this is going
to
be crazy.
Yeah, yeah. I tend to get a little nervous when it's one black person. Then I'll start to edit myself because I don't
feel
want them
bad
to
for that person.
Like, well, I don't want them to feel bad. Yeah. You know? So, but then I stop. Like, I do this joke that a black girl's pussy looks like a wallet. So then I'll think. I go, should I leave that out? It's a black woman. She's definitely not going to find it funny. But then if I edit it from my act, then it means that I had a mean intention to begin with. So I just leave. It don't change anything. They're there to see you. If you change it, then you're overthinking it.
And that's the genius of it, is you let George say it, and then you tell George on stage, like, wow, how could you say that?
Yeah.
That's horrible. And then, that's what people don't understand.
Yeah.
It's there is
a schizo. There has to be a level of schizophrenia. You said
probably,
it.
Yeah.
What do you mean, probably?
Yeah. But I mean, I don't.
I've heard story
to
about you and
stuff.
You know your buddies. You know, yeah. Lighten up, and you're yeah. like, I got to get George out of the car. He'll get mad at me. But yeah. that's you. You're saying you're putting on record that you feed into our you know the rest of us comics. You feed into the legend of Otto and George by arguing with the puppet off stage on purpose.
Well, when I did Opie and Anthony, I brought George the first time, and it's because they're still – even though it's two guys, they're still an audience, and they're going to have a childlike reaction to a dummy. You know, it brings a certain childlike element out of people, you know. But then after a while, I had to bring – because I can't get his voice unless I'm holding him. It's a fucked up thing.
Did you really?
Yeah, I can't get the voice accurately unless he's attached to my arm. It's weird. I did looping once.
Let me hear you do it.
It doesn't sound right to me. Maybe that's a little close.
A sugar.
That you can say.
A sugar.
Guilty. It's not right. It doesn't sound right to me.
It does sound a little different.
Yeah.
That's funny.
But to the listeners, you got to understand how strange that is, that there's a guy that's a ventriloquist act that can't do the voice of the figure unless his hand is in the figure.
Yeah.
Like that is like the movie magic.
I could do it. I could do it, but barely that it sounds right. It sounds like he's
got a sore
throat.
Didn't sound right to me.
It didn't sound right.
No.
Yeah.
Well, it's kind of like when you watch like the cast of The Simpsons do the voices like on Inside the Actors Studio,
right.
And you're like, it sounds a little
– yeah.
Something's a little different.
They're not in the booth. There's something that changes in their body or whatever when they're in that booth with you know the place that they're used to doing it.
Yeah, very funny. Very interesting, man. Very interesting. Can you do other voices and things at all?
Yeah, I do some impressions. Joe always tells me to do a decent Woody Allen, but
I'll do it.
You should do Woody Allen with
Star Smile Strong.
You should do Woody Allen with George and have George smash your Woody Allen.
Yeah.
I'm supposed to
Either it would work or George could call me a fucking talentless douchebag. So either way it's gonna work. Yeah. In the act.
I just fucking realized that
language.
But then I feel like I'm showing off if I start doing impressions. Now I'm doing impressions. I'm trying to show off how versatile I am. I hate that. Really?
That's all we do every night on stage is show off.
Yeah, but I don't want to look like I'm showing off. I just want to pull.
I don't think anybody would think that, Otto.
Really?
Come on. No way.
But how do I start that in the act? And the act is already set. I'm suddenly going
to wait for a 12-year-old Asian lady to sit in front of you.
Yeah.
On action, I want to go back to the dialogue. You know, in my life, there's been two times. The first time I really felt like I had made it. It had nothing to do with a show I had gotten or done. It was when I was on Martin Short's show, Jiminy Glick.
Yeah.
And I showed up. It's him and Michael McKean. And there's no pre-interview. And Bernie Brillstein goes, you just go out, you sit out. You guys just have a good time. And I realized, oh, my God, I've just been told by Bernie freaking Brillstein, just sit with Martin Short Michael McKean and just goof off and we're going to film that. Like I was trusted to that.
Yeah.
Dude, that's
and that to me made me feel like I had made it more than anything on my resume. And going to Otto to put it on Otto, when Otto was on action, there was stuff written and then what wound up on the cutting, what wound up got used but wasn't aired was Otto and Buddy Hackett.
Me and Hackett rewrote the scene. We
you
went
guys
ad-libbed
for like 3 hours.
Yeah.
And George was saying, Hackett goes, what are you in for? The puppet says, what are you in for? And he goes, faking a prescription, you? And he goes, caught in a part with a whore. You know, Hugh Grant, Eddie Murphy, the whole fucking thing.
Yeah.
And like no one went – that's what's amazing about the Otto and George. It is a phenomenon. Like would you agree?
Yeah.
Like, I remember
no one went, you can't say the whole fucking thing. Like, it never occurred to any of us that you can't say fuck on television.
Well, I think that's what, like, a mark of real admiration is. It's when everybody's mind gets off of what we shouldn't be doing right now and what we have to be doing and what the guidelines are here. They just look at the person and go, I trust you, dude. That's fucking hilarious. And that's
did you feel like
focus.
Yeah? Did you feel like after that day, did you drive home with a sense of like, well, I must have made it somehow because Buddy Hackett just wanted to ad lib with me?
Did I feel? I felt like the whole thing was arranged because you just wanted to see George and Hackett in a scene together. I didn't think
I wanted
I had
it on
earned
television
spot on TV because I don't audition for anything, never.
Well, neither did Hackett.
Yeah. Well, he's Buddy Hackett. You know, he's a, he's, well, you're Otto and George. But he's an institution, and he's been in a lot of features and family.
You're an
friendly
institution.
Things.
It's just a much smaller restaurant.
Yeah, exactly. I'm a good decent restaurant in a bad location. Whatever the fuck that meant.
But did you? So you didn't come away from that feeling like, wow. What was your feeling?
Oh yeah, I was on cloud nine, spending a day with Buddy Hackett.
But Buddy Hackett,
yeah,
you obviously in the
with
moment.
Palm trees and I'm in California. That was
you
amazing.
Had to have thought yeah. in the moment. Buddy Hackett really thinks I'm hysterical.
Yeah.
Right.
I don't know if he thought because he, you know, he might have been a little bit pissed that I wasn't doing the scene right. I don't know what he was thinking.
No, I mean it was hysterical. Do you remember all the lines?
I don't. I only remember a few lines. I do have the shooting script at home, but we were ad-libbing so much that they said if the actors come onto the set, you have to do the lines they wrote. I remember somebody telling me that.
Do you remember any of the ad-libs? Because I know all of them.
You do?
No, I don't. They're so brilliant.
I don't remember a single ad-lib. I just remember off-stage conversations I had with Hackett and He was. I remember somebody lit up a cigarette at one point. And he got really pissed.
Yeah, he was crazy.
He got really pissed. I mean, it was like 500 yards away. Yeah, what the fuck is smoking now? He goes, I started that non-smoking thing in Vegas.
Yeah,
you know, how'd that work out? Fucking gamblers want to smoke.
He's in the upper deck. They're like behind the end zone, and he's like, "Whose is that?"
Yeah,
sensitive nose. Like the princess and the pea, but with noses.
Yeah.
That's you, I want to hear what Hackett said to you, but I remember you ad-libbing in the middle of it. The guard, Hackett's crying, wants to know where I am to get him out of jail. And George looks at Hackett and goes, "How about you suck my dick while the guard sings Beatles songs?"
And, really?
But Hackett never broke, did he? I don't remember him
laughing.
Breaking.
No. He was good.
And he goes, "Listen to me, you little piss putt. This is Hackett." So this is the exchange that I got to put on wax. Yeah. I got to let it drop, as the kids say.
That's what I'm saying, man.
It was, and I've explained this to people in my regular life. It was like Ali Frazier. Like when any guy could take a knee, like the blows that they were taking, you kept waiting for someone to take a knee. And neither guy went down because it's Hackett. And Otto and George ad-libbing and just let the cameras go. He goes, "Why don't you suck my dick while the guard sings Beatles songs?" And Hackett goes, "Listen to me, you little piss pot." He's pointing to a dummy. "Listen to me, you little." All right, so I want to get it exactly right. But you got to keep in mind, Otto Petersen is asleep.
Yeah.
Right. Right. He's out of. They've cut him out of the shot.
Right.
He's just the guy that happens to be in jail, and they're just. We never explain it. There just happens to be a puppet in jail,
all right.
And it's alive. Yeah. And no, it's the most beautiful thing. All it's right. Fucking beautiful, man. Cruise and taps. So Otto's asleep. It's a master shot, and then it like they just clip him out, and then George goes, "What are you in for?" And he goes, "I faked a prescription." And he goes, "Caught in the park with a whore, Eddie Murphy, Hugh Grant, the whole fucking thing." And he goes, "Hey, what do you say we get his attention?" And then he goes, "How about you suck my dick while the guard sings Beatles songs?" Hackett pokes the dummy and goes, "Listen to me, you little piss pot. You'll be lucky to get a suck at a snotty end of my fuck stick." And the puppet raises his eyebrows and goes, "Great sermon, Father."
You remember that? Oh, God.
Oh, that's fucking beautiful.
Yeah. In the place. It's just, it's like, I don't even know how to, like, that's just people ad-libbing.
Oh, my God.
And but with
Buddy Hackett was so adorable. He was so funny.
Wearing those weird driving gloves for his arthritis.
That guy always worked. I heard he was, like, great, like, right out of the gate when he was, like, 15. He was already, like, doing dates.
He was a cop in Fort Lee.
He was?
He was a sheriff. He was a real sheriff, not like a bullshit sheriff.
That blows my mind.
And what happened
was
he was doing Skidoo on Broadway, and then, you know, it ends at like 10, and he'd be back in Fort Lee at 11, and he did midnight to 8 a.m. shifts. He went through the academy and everything.
Jesus.
Because he was making money on Broadway, check this. You'll like this.
Yeah.
He never took a check. Every check he took, he forwarded to the PBA, the Patrolman's Benevolent Association.
Oh.
So you can imagine, he probably became a sheriff in like 8 months.
Oh.
You're like, oh, my God, this guy's not taking a check. He just keeps giving it so we can have a party at the end of the year. So he became
his cop pay or the Broadway pay?
His cop pay. Oh. Every time they gave him a check, he said, "Just forward it. Do me a favor. Just forward it over." Like, he went on patrols and everything. He always had a license to carry his whole life. And once I needed a pistol for the home.
Right.
And you got to wait
like 4 days, because that's a great way to weed out maniacs.
Yeah.
Make them wait until Thursday.
Right. Yeah. Right. Well, you know, it helps not prevent a crime of passion, Jay. You know what I mean?
So while I was waiting, Hackett lent me a 38, and he goes, and on the butt of the gun, it says, to Buddy Hackett, fondly, the Florida Sheriff's Association. Yeah. And etched on the barrel is a palm tree. And I'm like, you almost have to commit a murder just because that's the murder weapon.
Why?
Because like, just the murder weapon says, I'm not Buddy Hackett. Yeah. So if I just give it to some like crip and he shoots a blood and the murder weapon says, to Buddy. It's a sheriff gun to a gift to a comic. It's too bizarre for words.
So now they're going to be looking for Buddy Hackett?
Yeah. Like, what was Buddy Hackett doing with the Grape Street Crips? So he picks up the phone and he calls. He's in Beverly Hills. He goes, Beverly Hills, West Hollywood, Hollywood. He calls all three police departments. He goes, hi, this is Buddy Hackett. I just lent a friend of mine a pistol. He's driving home. If you pull him over and find it, I'd appreciate it if you didn't give him a hard time.
Oh, really?
And I was like, all right. I did like 80. I blew red lights.
Why did he think he needed a gun?
He always had one at all times. Yeah. He said it's like
– I mean, even if you'd be like backstage in Vegas, always, he'd have a pistol on him?
Always on him. Licensed to carry. And he said it's awful because when you leave the house without it, you panic. It's like if you – try going to the store without your phone.
Oh.
Like if you go to 7-Eleven without your phone, halfway there you're like, do I go back? Do I get
it? Was he paranoid? Did he think somebody – I mean, who attacks a comedian?
I think he had it and he told me he had it. And then once you go places without it, you're so used to having it and that supreme confidence of any situation I can protect myself
and
others.
Plus he was a cop, so he had that also in the background.
He said he went out to the Malibu house once and he didn't have his pistol. And he went all the way back to Beverly Hills to get his pistol and come back because he didn't feel safe sleeping. I slept at his house once in Malibu.
Yeah.
And he goes, all right, have fun. And he leaves. And like 10 minutes later, there's a knock on the door because he gave me his keys. And he goes, let me in. Let me in. He goes, look, there's a 35 in the nightstand. There's one in the chamber. Please don't kill yourself. And I opened the drawer. There's just guns everywhere.
Wow. Jesus Christ.
And that one said, two rip torn.
Jesus.
And you own a pistol now.
No, I do not.
Oh, you know, okay. So
no, I got rid of it. I had to return it.
Was this during the L.A. riots or something? Were you
9/11, you know, I had one shortly before that, and then I just drove around collecting bottled water and cash.
Oh, really?
I was going to run the Hollywood Hills.
Wow.
it was like Red Dawn. I was going to be in the Wolverines.
You know John Mulroney is? Yeah. John Mulroney, he's a gun nut. That guy always fucking – well, he's always had a pistol on him. He was crazy. He used to shoot canned hams behind Pips in Brooklyn and blow them up with these exploding bullets. And his brother was a cop. His brother used to pull a boat up to Coney Island and get on a megaphone and go, attention, you will never own a boat. You will never achieve what the white man has achieved. That is all.
That's what his brother would say?
Yeah, he was a cop.
The cop would say that.
Yeah, yeah.
Nice fella.
Coney Island, God.
Nice fella.
Yeah, it's pretty brutal, right?
Jesus Christ almighty. Yeah. How did he not get in trouble for doing that?
I don't know. He's just a fucking racist Brooklyn guy, you know?
Mulroney's like a radio guy now.
Somebody said Mulroney, he was on, he had a coke problem. He went to Betty Ford. Then he came out and they go, Mulroney's doing psychic readings now. And somebody said, well, maybe all the drugs and alcohol made him psychic. And then somebody said, if that was true, Otto would be Nostradamus. My friend Richie Triola ad-libbed that. I thought that was hilarious.
I've never seen John Mulroney on Dice's, like, pay-per-view fucking Valentine's Day Massacre special or some shit.
Did he do an act?
There was a heckler on a goddamn pay-per-view special, and Mulroney came out.
It's the Dice crowd.
Yeah, annihilated this fucking guy.
Yeah, Mulroney is
like
very
just
good
took him apart
work
at the goddamn seams, dude. And I remember I'd seen him like on stand-up on Comedy Central.
Yeah.
And I was like, you know, back I was 12 years old at the time. So I thought everything was, you know, if I saw a comic be clean on TV, I thought that just meant they're clean.
Yeah.
So it was so weird. I remember being like, that guy's, oh, my God, he's saying these terrible things.
That's when it wasn't even called Comedy Central, right? It was
Comedy Channel.
Comedy Channel, yeah. Right. Yeah.
Did Dice steal from you?
Yeah, but that was many years ago.
Well, I've been accused of stealing from you, so, I mean, it's you're rocking.
Maybe you guys are right, and I should just fucking take whatever I like and just write a better act. But
no, your act is great. It's you. It's a completely unique.
Yeah.
But you and I had battles on ONA about using the word yoo-hoo, the euphemism yoo-hoo for diarrhea.
Well, my friend I don't want to go into that. But with the dice, it was
It's always – people can't wait to call you and stir shit up. Yeah. Everyone's a coat holder. They go, hey, Jay Moore, Dice, Otto, this – let me hold your coat. You guys go fight it out.
My friend Don Jameson opens with Dice all the time, and he goes He goes, I'm sick of people saying Dice stole from Otto, whatever. And I go, did you ever hear me say it? Not once, right? It's other people trying to, you know, get me upset or, you know, want to hear the inside story. I had outgrown doing the nursery rhymes, and Dice, somebody goes, hey, man, Dice in California, and he's doing your act. It's like.
So you did nursery rhymes
back
in the day.
Yeah, it was a small part of my act, and I guess he saw more potential in it than I did. And created the Dice. He didn't do the Dice character when I used to work with him. He just did.
Are you guys friends now?
No, not really. I mean, I saw him at Florentine's wedding, and we hugged and everything. And then I was waiting for him to come over and, you know, have more of an exchange with him. You know, how you doing, Otto? What's, you know, how you been? I haven't seen you.
Thanks for the career.
Yeah. You know, I thought he should have come over and settled, you know, had engaged me a little more. I thought, you know, the ball's in your court. I fucking hugged you, you know, say something to me. And then I saw him having a powwow with Artie Lang in the corner. I go, well, fuck him.
So you did.
We talked about this on
a Monday. Yeah. So you did nursery rhymes.
Yeah.
And then all of a sudden Dice got famous for nursery rhymes.
Everybody said that was the funniest thing in his act, and that was his signature mark, and I should fucking. I go, what do you want me to do? Shoot him with a crossbow? It's over.
Sure.
Yeah.
Were they the same nursery rhymes?
Well, yeah. There was an old woman who lived in a shoe. She had so many children, her uterus fell out. Mine. Little boy blue, he needed the money. That's mine.
Does George say it?
Yeah, yeah. And I would do this whole, would you like to hear a poem? And I would clear his throat. That always got a big laugh. That always got a gigantic laugh when he would go, like that, before the poem.
Well, good.
And then Dice was like, his idol was Elvis. And I also knew Eddie Murphy before he became a gigantic movie star. And his idol was Elvis. I go, I don't understand how a comedian's idol could be a singer. You know, it should be – shouldn't your idol be Carlin or Pryor? You know what I mean? It's like
– Who's your idol?
In comedy?
No, in architecture.
You half Danish chunky.
I'm like everybody else. I think Carlin and Richard Pryor are this shit, and there's nobody even close. Yeah.
No, yeah. Carlin's the number one.
Yeah,
so, and Pryor's my two, but yeah.
But a long two, distant two. It took me a while because just some. You know what it is with Carlin?
Yeah.
It's like somebody could do Carlin off Broadway as a one man show. Like
yeah.
You take any of those specials and just present it. They're essays.
Yeah.
It's not like he just took bits.
Yeah,
there's
he's
no
amazing.
I like when he goes. People used to say I'm a comic that writes his own material, and then he realized. I'm a writer who performs his own material.
Right.
Oh.
And that was the big
shift. That's what he said?
Yeah, that was the big shift in his mind.
Right.
I'll get you the book.
Oh, okay.
And his thing – I mean, that's the thing, too, with Pryor. Pryor has made me laugh harder than Carlin makes me laugh, but I love Carlin more. And I think part of that, too, is due to the fact that we got to see a complete career arc with Carlin, and it never stopped until he died.
Yeah.
Pryor did three specials, essentially – And then focused on movies and then got MS and it was over.
Yeah, you know never really did a good movie that matched his talent.
Yeah, you know.
I can't name one great comedy movie with Pryor in
it. I like Stir Crazy a lot.
Stir Crazy's good, but it's not classic. He should have been in Blazing Saddles. That was supposed to be him, the black
guy. Cleavon Little?
Yeah. Mel Brooks wanted him, but they wouldn't sign off on him or whatever.
They probably couldn't get insurance.
Yeah, yeah.
If you – what movie would you most want to be in besides Stroker Ace?
Would I want to be in? I'd like to be in a really gory horror film. That would be I think that would be cool. Yeah.
Do you want to act? If you could just eschew the puppet and just go out.
It's got to happen organically. I'm not going to start going out and fucking auditioning. It's got to be somebody
well,
wants
that really
me in
is,
a movie.
That is kind of the way to act.
Yeah, I know.
You
I'm not going
to go
I'm
out.
Not going to do it.
All right. So I guess the answer is no.
There was a movie with
if they just hand it to me on a silver platter and they find me in my crack den in Staten Island, sure, I'll do Ron Howard a favor. But, you know, I'm not going to read for it like some ham and egger. All right, we're running out of time here. It's at Otto and George, and your website, ottoandgeorge.com.
Yeah, and also I got a lot of stuff on YouTube. If they want to see Telecrappies, it's in two parts.
I love Telecrappies
on YouTube, and it's all there on my website and shit. Yeah.
I'm most happy about this, and we never got to George, and George can kiss my ass
because
he's an inanimate object.
He's watching season one and two of The Sopranos. You know?
He's right. Season two sucks.
See?
Yeah.
It's a nice callback.
I think it was important, this, because a lot of people wanted the dummy to come on and just smash everybody, but –
Yeah,
I think this is way more important, and I appreciate you just being honest. And I don't think people realize how much work goes into what you do. There's so much, and again, I keep saying Colin, but if that was the discussion we had, and Joe and I have talked about it, sitting on trains on
you
the way
a
to
great
gigs.
Colin.
All right.
Does that come naturally, or do you have to sit and
no,
study
I know.
It?
What am I going
to
do? Rehearse me?
Yeah.
You know? I'd be kind of, I think the kids call it meta, you know, and not meta world peace. You know, he's like someone from, you know, John Mulready's brothers who's yelling at Laker games. They should have had him be coach of the Lakers. They'd play defense, you know. But attention, you know, it's a pseudonym. Attention Lakers. You'll never have a boat. Except for, you know, second unit point guard. He can have one. He went to Maryland. He's a terrapin, for crying out loud. No, I just call them turtles. Sorry.
We've been very Colin heavy this month.
That's very good.
But I don't think people realize the amount of work that goes into, like, when you do crowd work. And I did a scene with Tom Cruise where it's his close-up. And during the scene, he realized I was too far away from the camera, so his eye line wasn't going to match.
Oh.
Does that make sense?
Yeah, well,
okay.
Yeah,
so he knew that the shot was from, like, his nipples up.
Right.
So just below his nipples, as he's talking to me, he takes his finger and he points. He points me over like this, like move closer to the mat box.
Right.
As he's talking.
Right. Wow.
And as he's talking, he's like going, go, 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 with his finger.
Yeah.
And then I move my head over to the mat box of the camera, and he gives me a fucking okay sign by his belly. Never stops talking.
Wow.
And I've never seen that until I saw you.
So, yeah, he's disconnected this part of his body, and he's doing other shit. That's pretty cool.
Just from the neck up.
Yeah. My meathead from the neck up.
But you have this total disconnect. You have we should do this again sometime whenever you get out to L.A. or whatever, if you ever stop playing the tri-state area.
How was it with Clint Eastwood was my boyhood action hero. I loved it. I've seen every movie since Thunderbolt and Lightfoot that he's put out. What was that experience like working with Clint Eastwood?
He asked me one day, he said, JJ, would you like to join me for a Czechoslovakian beer in a sports bar? And I go, no, I don't drink. And he goes, well, then I guess you're done for the day.
Really?
But
he
said,
you turn down a beer with Clint Eastwood?
Well, I'm not going to fall off the wagon and start my days over.
Yes.
Yeah, have one
That's
beer.
What I said.
Man
I
up.
Do a show in my act. I do a thing in my act where I'm like, maybe I should have just drank with Clint, fell off the wagon. Then I would have been J. Edgar Hoover, win the Oscar. I'm doing blow off a toilet tank at the Shrine Auditorium.
No.
I get my Oscar, go to the rehab
just
the next
the story.
Day. Go to the rehab the next
you
day.
You order a beer and you don't
and go,
drink
I'm
it.
Here.
You wouldn't
I'm
even
jam
that
an
you
alcoholic.
Didn't drink it.
And I'm here because my life got real manageable.
You just order a beer and don't drink it just for the story to have, you know, to have.
Well, I said no. Do you want me to tell you what happened? You guys want to fucking make fun of me?
Have a fucking water.
That's not what he asked. It was specific.
Well,
would you like
go.
To join me for a Czechoslovakian beer? And I said, no, thank you, but I appreciate it. And he says, well, then I guess you're done for the day.
That's great.
But he said it like.
Did he seem like pissed a little?
Very.
Really?
And I'm in the van going back to the hotel like, did I just get fired?
Wow.
And then the next day I show up and he goes, how long has it been since you've had booze or alcohol in your body?
Yeah.
And I go, I don't know. I never really kept track. May 5th, 1998. You know, I don't know. And he goes, you know, my problem was never booze or drugs. Are you wearing a mic?
Right.
Which is a totally weird question if you're in a movie, because you wear a mic and there's a boom operator guy, and Matt Damon's next to me wearing a mic.
Yeah,
Clint Eastwood heard us act, so he knows we're wearing mics because he heard it. And I go, yeah. And he goes, cover it up. So I put my hand over my mic, which is like in my sweater against my chest, like my collarbone. But meanwhile, Matt Damon's got a hot mic right next to me, and the boom guy's now like getting closer, like, oh, this is going to be good.
Yeah.
And he goes, my problem was never booze or alcohol, JJ. My problem was always P-U-S-S-Y.
Wow.
And I'm like, oh, my God. And he spelled it like so the sound guy wouldn't hear it. You know what I mean? Like he spelled it.
That's weird.
He should have asked you if you had a podcast.
Jesus.
What? She's echoing you. You're wearing a mic, and what? Now you're on your podcast just telling the story to 250.
How many years
people.
Ago was this Eastwood?
3 years ago.
What shape was he in, would you say, physically?
Great.
I'll
tell you a quick
good?
Story. He, Otto and, at OttoandGeorge.com, at OttoandGeorge, OttoandGeorge.com. And,
I love Clint Eastwood. I fucking
not for the faint of heart. Consider yourselves warned. Do you get sick of that when you do gigs and it's like triple X rated, beware? Yeah, or do you like that they warn everybody?
They can't ask for their money back. It's fine.
Very smart.
Yeah.
They did a tsunami scene in Hawaii in the movie Hereafter. And the actress is French. There's a picture boat and there's like four boats if you're filming in the ocean. I said, I wasn't there. It's just what they told me. And he goes, tell her I need her to face this way because the sun – I wanted the sun in her eyes. And like they're yelling to somebody in another boat on the other side of the lady, but she's French, so it has to be translated to like the kid actor in the water with her. Oh, and meanwhile, just – you got 40 people floating in the Pacific Ocean. Like Warner Brothers is like, how about we just shoot it, Clint? Yeah. And he goes, God damn it. And he takes his pants off and his shirt off and in his underwear dives into the Pacific Ocean and swims like 40 yards – like beautiful freestyle all the way out to the lady, and in perfect French goes, maintenant, c'est j'ai besoin qu'on cette garçon dit ça. And in perfect French, tells her what he wants. And then instead of swimming back to the picture boat, he just kind of like treads water out of – he knows where the frame
out
is.
Out of camera, yeah.
But he's at – I'm sure Warner Brothers is like, somebody get him. He's going to get eaten by a orca.
79-year-old man, yeah.
He's out there treading water, and it's like 20 minutes.
Wow.
And then he goes, all right, call it. God. Wow. And then he just swims back to the boat and puts his clothing. He goes, does anyone have a towel?
Jeez.
And the hair and makeup people have towels in case like something gets spilled. So he's got these little like bullshit towels that you get at like Bally's gym.
Yeah, yeah.
And he's got like 40 of them. And the producer guy that was telling me the story, I go, how weird was it? He goes, weirder than you think. I go, why? He goes, he wasn't winded.
When he starts a scene, he doesn't yell action, right? He goes, whenever you're ready or something
He goes,
like that.
Whenever you're ready.
Because he says it startles actors when you go, action, like that. And
he goes, when was the last time you yelled action in your life?
Yeah.
I go, never. He goes, then why the hell would I yell it in the lobby of a bank with people playing make-believe?
Wow. Yeah. That's awesome.
He goes, my first day in the scene, on the set, you only get one take, so I was terrified.
Yeah.
That's the only time
They told you going in.
Everyone tells you. That's the thing with him. It's one take and it's good enough. Really? And if you got hired, it's because he trusts that you can just do it. Don't bullshit us.
Wow. What if you flub a fucking line?
Then obviously you got to do it over, Joe. They're not going to keep it at Iwo Jima. Yeah.
But I mean,
the Korean guy goes, that's sorry. I meant to go.
Let's explain all the details here.
That's what's amazing about Iwo Jima. It's all in Korean. No one knows that they're ruining their lines.
How did you do it? You did fine?
I did fine, but what happened was the guy. The steady cam operator had to walk backwards as me and Matt Damon walk really quickly because I'm super excited to show him his new office.
Yeah.
And there's a weird office building. So a couple times the steady cam guy, like his hip hit a radiator or like they're like, I'm sorry, I lost focus because the timing was off. So the camera operator messed up like three times. So then all the pressure's off.
Yeah.
Already the day's bananas for Clint. So if I mess up, I know he's going to chalk it up to one of those days.
Yeah. That's great.
But he goes.
He talks like that.
Yeah. We go in the elevator.
How would you like a Czechoslovakian beer?
He goes. You and Matt, can I talk to you guys? Boys, can I talk to you boys for a second?
Wow.
You guys are going to start here in the elevator. And every other movie, it's so. Like your footsteps, there's tape on the floor for the camera operator. Like when you get to this piece of tape, it's 14 feet. When you get to this piece of tape, it's 20 feet. When you get to – not with Clint. He just – you guys come out of the – the shot starts when you guys come out of the elevator and just come down the hallway and we'll follow you. You guys talk until you go into the office and we may cut. Just keep talking because I might follow you guys in there and see if I can make it work.
Yeah.
And you go, okay. And then you go – all right, so you guys go to the elevator, or whenever you're ready, I'll pick you up. So you're standing in an elevator, and Matt Damon's going, dude, let me tell you something. Just enjoy yourself, because this is going to be over before you know it.
Wow.
It's going to be over before – and you realize as Matt Damon's talking, Clint Eastwood's 14 feet away going, why aren't they coming out yet? So you go, should we go out? And he goes, oh, yeah. So you literally just walk out and start talking, and it's just this well-oiled machine just starts walking backwards as you do your thing.
That's fucking amazing, man.
And everyone,
really cool.
You'll love this story. Yeah. Angelina Jolie in the, what's the movie she did where her kid got taken? Changeling?
Yeah. That's it. Eastwood.
He goes, honey, you come out and go to the window. And that's the shot.
Yeah.
And she goes, well, I think this character, that's something Clint doesn't like.
He doesn't like that.
Don't bring any ideas to work.
Yeah.
I got it. We mapped, it's Clint Eastwood movie.
Yeah.
And I've hired people that I think are just going to do well in this system.
He doesn't like pretension, right? And that
no, he, what
shit.
Does he know? Yeah. You know, yeah. You know.
What does he know?
I meant that. You know, what does he know about pretension? You know, yeah. He just shows up and goes, all right, why don't you take off all your clothes and we can have sex?
Pussy.
Don't make a big deal out of it.
Yeah.
If you're going to cry, I'll call someone else.
Yeah.
Jay. So she goes, I was thinking. And then as soon as she says, I was thinking, everybody's like, oh. He goes, I come down the stairs. I can look for my son in the kitchen. I can look around. And she has like this whole thing mapped out. He goes, well, why don't you come down the stairs and look out the window? Because that's how all the boys have already prepared themselves for it. And then we'll talk about what you want after I get that.
Wow.
And she goes, okay. And she goes, because I just think he goes, I hear you, sweetheart. The guys have just set up this shot. Let's just keep them happy, and we'll keep rolling along, okay?
Wow.
She goes, okay, great. She comes down the stairs. Everywhere she walks in the house, behind her, guys are packing up lights and walking them out of the house.
Oh.
And he's going, just keep looking at me.
Oh.
Just keep looking at me out the window. Just keep staring out that window. Where could he be?
Yeah.
Where could he be? But he doesn't want her to turn around because they're literally like rolling up like carpets and shit. So when she turns around, she's in an abandoned house.
Wow, nobody gave a shit about her little idea.
Yeah. She goes to talk to him. They're like, oh, I think he went home.
Oh, God, that's great.
I love it.
And he goes, oh, I guess there was a misunderstanding. I thought you agreed to do it the way the guy set it up.
Wow.
Because they've been here for 2 weeks working real hard. I didn't want
so
to disrespect
them. So they had a cross
them.
Relationship, or was that just
no,
that one
I think
moment?
He put the hammer down early. Like
he does that. He lays the law down. Yeah. I heard
Hillary
he did
Swank,
that. I heard he did that with Kevin Costner in that movie, A Perfect World. He pulled some
good
tantrum.
Movie, man.
Yeah, he pulled some tantrum, and Eastwood just shot like a guy, like his double, in a long shot. He goes, I'll shoot the whole fucking movie in a long shot, and you can go home now if you can. You know, Costner told that story that he goes, okay, yeah, I got to do it Clint's way. Have a little respect.
Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
Jesus
2 weeks Christ. In. Good. And we're in overtime, by the way, Warriors. 2 weeks.
Warriors?
That's what they've named themselves.
It's a
M-O-H-R.
Cult now?
Yeah. Yeah. Big one. That buys
awesome.
Merch. Shush.
That's great, man.
Shush you.
That's great.
It's a big one that buys stuff on the jmoore.com, and then they go to the Amazon link. And they're going to go look at all your stuff and hit you up on Twitter, and you'll get a bunch of followers.
Yeah. Laugh.com if you want to buy my DVD.
Why don't you just have it on ottoandgeorge.com?
I'm not set up for that, credit cards and shit.
Oh.
Yeah.
So you let somebody else do it.
Yeah, I get
everyone's
50%.
Got a hand in your pocket.
I'm friends with Marshall Burl, Milton Burl's nephew. He runs Laugh.com. He's a very good guy. He used to manage the band Rad.
Really?
Yeah.
Love round it. And round, baby.
Yeah, yeah.
Love it.
Yeah, he's a good guy.
Clint doesn't give you any instructions, ever.
Wow.
He tells you, we'll go in there and you guys come out and I'll pick you up. Never has any instructions whatsoever. Hillary Swank doing Million Dollar Baby, which she won the Oscar for.
Yeah.
She's boxing her cock off. Like she's fighting and fighting and crying and overcoming adversity. And 2 weeks in, she goes to the camera operator, the guy that just sits on the camera and, you know, looks through the loop. And she goes, hi, can I talk to you at lunch? And that is never going to be good. It's either like sexual harassment or I don't like the way you're looking at me. Like a camera operator is not used to Academy Award winner because she won for Boys Don't Cry.
Yeah.
Going, hey, at lunch, come to my trailer. I need to talk to you. And
yeah.
It's like the guy's panic stricken.
Yeah.
And Clint has the same crew for 18 years. Everyone is the same for 18 years. So he goes in and she goes, hi, close the door. And he's like, oh, my God, this can't be good.
Yeah.
She goes, I just got to ask you one question. And he goes, what? She goes, am I doing a good job? And he goes, yeah. And she goes, because he doesn't talk to me.
Oh.
And she starts like crying to the camera operator.
Yeah.
Like, that's she won the Oscar.
Yeah, for that. And that's the movie she was talking about. Am I doing good?
During that movie,
yeah,
she had to call the camera operator who's seen everything because he's looking through the, you know.
So if you give Eastwood a whole what's my character's motivation.
You will be fired.
Really?
Yeah. He watches tapes of everybody that audition. Oh, that's the other thing you like about him. He's never in the audition. He goes, it's nerve-wracking enough to audition. How much more nerve-wracking would it be with me sitting behind everybody judging you?
Yeah, Dirty Harry squinting at you from the corner of the room. That's
do
it
again.
Very unnerving.
This time, show me some vulnerability.
Oh, man.
So yeah, you do it. He looks at tapes like a crazy person. He just sits like Howard Hughes in a room, like it must be 3/4 of an inch of water in the bottle.
The story is that he crosses lines out of his early movies. He would cross like lines out like crazy on Fistful of Dollars. He says, I don't need to say that. That's unnecessary. And it's like, what actor does it? Most actors count their lines to see that they have as many as the other guy.
Walken's the only other one.
Well, he takes away the punctuation.
He just made that shit up. It's a good story. But he'll just go, I wouldn't say that.
The punctuation thing's not true?
Nobody goes through a fucking script and goes, let me take out this period. Because then everywhere there's a mark, you know that there was punctuation.
Oh.
He said on the Actor's Studio that's the first thing he does.
Takes out punctuation?
His lips to my ears.
I was on a set with him and I saw a script and it was just a script.
Yeah. Oh.
And he just speaks funny.
Wow.
He does speak funny.
Yeah, I was telling Joe.
Funny how?
Joe Conte about Suicide Kings. I was telling him about that.
It's good.
Yeah, yeah.
Every time you talk about a conversation with Joe, I didn't realize halfway through the podcast you were talking about him.
Yeah, yeah, Joe.
And he's muscle going, me and Joe, I mean, we talk comedy, man. He knows everything. I'm like, when the fuck did we talk comedy?
Yeah, you were like, the peacock came out like, all right.
No, I was talking about you when
you were
I said
about
that.
Me?
Yeah.
When did we talk about
he's
comedy?
Just being nice.
Backstage,
let him have it.
Backstage in the Nasty Show, you were like this historian.
The guy with all the stuff in his
comedy.
Face.
You've
That's
seen
right.
every. Like every fucking comedian.
Why don't you guys just throw each other and get it over
I've
with?
Seen all of it. Did you ever hear his Keitel?
No.
Really?
What's your favorite Keitel movie?
Bad Lieutenant, Mean
Look,
Streets.
The series must go 7 games. The revenue money alone. Look, I went to the ballpark today and I saw Daryl Strawberry. He looked me in my eye. He told me he's saving it for the big one. It great. Never could go any other way. There's no jobs in this town, are there?
That's great.
He goes nuts like with the cartel. That's the best because he's all whacked out on crack.
He's really good at that.
How stupid is Victor Argo and David Caruso? They believe him.
Yeah, yeah.
He goes, you want to make money? Leave it on
Wait,
the mess.
Wait, David Caruso was in Bad Lieutenant?
Yeah, he's one of the cops.
No shit.
And Victor Argo. And
You're
he's
not
trying,
confusing that with The King in New York? Where
I am.
Yeah.
You're right. I apologize.
What about Mean Streets? That's a great one, too.
I don't remember his lines. I remember De Niro's lines.
He's not very Keitel. That's like early De Niro.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And early Keitel.
You make her come. Does she do that?
Yeah.
All right. At Otto and George, thank you, brother, very much.
Thank you, Jay. Next time you see,
what puppet acts do you like? Any?
I like Dunham. I think he's a wonderful artist. He's great. Jeff Dunham.
What's your favorite puppet that he has?
Oh, my favorite puppet that he has? I guess the Dead Terrorist is pretty good. That's kind of clever.
Would you ever bring another guy into the act?
No, I tried that. I had a fag, Phil the Fruit. I tried that. I couldn't get a character for him. And, now you're talking two boxes. Yeah, Phil Fruit. He was a homosexual.
How was his voice?
You know, probably.
No,
like,
I don't know.
No,
you know. You said it.
I thought you said it.
I never got it right. So, no, I still have that.